Hi, this is MC Zetti for a new episode of my tutorial about automation with RFTools, RFTools Control and XNet. This is part 2 and here we will talk about more advanced features, but first let's mention a few blocks that have perhaps lost a bit of its use since XNet and so on can do this much easier, but it's still there. So one is the item filter. So let's say you configure it like this. East side is input, outside, downside is output. So you can toggle them like that. And that's for this slot. So let's disable this. Only input now. If you then put items in it, they go through the hopper. They go inside this slot. That's the buffer. If I set that to output, they can pass through. However, if I set the filter, yeah, they still are extracted, but no new ones are inserted because the filter blocks it. So that's a way. For example, what can you do with this? I'm just going to give a few examples. Now they are going through. Say you have iron ore and gold ore, and say you have it's a bit hard to use this because with NRIU it would for example be much easier, but then you don't actually need it. So but let's make an example anyway. Iron ore and gold ore input and output. So let's remove this one. So basically what happens now, but let's bypass the hopper, let's do it directly here, that's faster. So you see gold ore gets inserted but only accepted in this slot, and it immediately goes through. Oh yeah, it's now doing the iron. So iron gets in this slot, but it has nowhere to go because the upper side is not connected to anything. And now it will do the gold. Yeah, now it will do the gold. So the item filter is just a very simple way to filter items based on conditions that you set here. It's powerful in a way, but it's limited and it doesn't have much speed, so not very useful these days. I'm probably not going to port over this block in RFTools for 1.13 or 14. Another block which is useful is the power delay. So let's make a simple setup to this explain how you get used this. Okay, so I made an old setup. First, let me show you. This is a big RFTools power cell, and this is a smaller RFTools power cell. So this holds our initial power, and this is backup power. So this monitor is set to monitor this, and it will give a redstone signal when power goes below 50%, which is almost the case. This is a power relay. It gets power from so if you put one down left and right, so it gets power from the left side and right side. Basically when redstone is off, these settings are valid. When redstone is off, these settings are valid. So at this point the RF monitor doesn't give a redstone signal, so we should look at this, and it means it's getting power from the left side, from this side, at the maximum rate of 50,000 RF per tick. That's more than such a cell can handle, by the way. And it outputs upper to the up at the same at the upside. If power goes below 50%, the monitor will turn on, and it will start. These all don't matter, so let's disable them. it's less confusing. So the redstone will be on, and it will start accepting power from the right side and giving power to the same upper side. Here's a small XNet network. This is our consumer, our power consumer. And let's enable the channel. So it's getting power now, and it's getting power from this side. This is constant. And at some point, this will go below. Let's expand this so the power input gets higher. Because the bigger this is, the much power it can input. Yeah, it switched, you see? This one is now capped at 50%, and now it's taking power from that one. So that's one thing that you can do with the power relay. It allows you to switch power flow depending on various conditions. In this case, condition with power relay, but you could also tag wireless redstone to it if you want. Here is another setup. We have a builder, which we know is a very power consuming device, and it's getting power from the power relay, but only while power stays above 10%. So this will give redstone signal if we go below 10%, and this is configured to give, if there's no redstone signal, it will give power from the transfer power from the left side to the right, from the right side to the left. This is input to red, so that's input from here, output to the here. But if there's a redstone signal, it will stop doing that. So it's already full because we let's to illustrate this. Just increase the maximum power so that we are easier. So now we are below 10%. So let's give it a bit more power. Oh no. Oh yeah, we are above 10%, was reading wrong. Okay, so let's remove this one. Enable builder. So it's filling up. Let's increase the speed. Okay, so now it should go below 10% soon. So this is a way. So the builder will of course keep running if it was running, because it will keep on running on internal power. But this is a way that you can, if you are limited on power and you want to make sure that power series of machines are only running if there's enough power left, non-critical machines, then you can use setup like this with the power relay. So the power relay is actually a pretty useful block, I think, especially if you want to have more control about how your power is used and how it flows. So in next part here I will talk a bit about XNet. Many people will people already know, but I will give a quick overview and maybe show you some things that you didn't know. So the basic of XNet is the controller, and let's get rid of these. Let's pick a few chests and maybe a builder and that. So one thing, XNet can transfer power, items, liquids, and some other things, but it's always best to have the control itself directly powered by something, because it can only transfer power when it has power on its own. So if you just depend on the controller itself to power itself, you can get problems if power runs out for some reason. It can be hard to kickstart the network from working again. So a very simple XNet setup. Let's just do it like that. Okay. So one thing you already notice, if you sneak click, you can let's put some blocks here. Find your cables again, even if you threw walls, but you have to hold another network cable for that, so you can see them through walls. Can be very useful to find your stuff. Also, this works with facades. XNet facade. Sneak right click. Facade, you don't have to sneak right click, you will automatically see it. And yeah, while it's a facade, it's automatically visible. Unless you do it like this, of course. Okay, so that's about the facade. So if you have a simple network like this, what you can do is you can create. So here you see all connected devices, and you can create an item channel. Say, which block is this? Double click, and it will highlight that block, so that's easy to see. So let's make that the input chest, let's make that the output chest, and then it doesn't work because what did I forget? Oh, I mixed input and output. Should be like this. Okay. So now it's working. You can increase the speed, at least with an advanced one. This is the fastest you can go with a normal connector, but you can set it to stack, which should already help a lot. Like that. So now it transfers as a stack. There are many things you can do here. So count. Can do it with like that, for example, and it will do 10 at a time. If it has 10, it will not. It will keep on doing even if it has less than 10, but it will try to do 10. So that's one thing you can do. Okay, so a few other features. Say you have multiple chests, and multiple connectors. By the way, another feature, if you have, for example, a blue connector that you want to put here, but you don't want it to connect to one of the sides, so you can disable like that. So that way you can make sure it doesn't connect to that side. You can also give connectors a name. So let's call this input. Then you can immediately see input here. It is. That's the input connector. Okay, these are all outputs. So by default, this channel will do item distribution mode priority. So that means they all go to whatever is first in this case, because they have the same priority. But if I would set this one, which is the middle one, priority 1, they should now go to here. Okay, so that's one way you can do, but you can also set it to round robin, and let's set this to single, and then it should, they will be distributed over the different chests. So that's one thing you can do. Okay, let's pick them up again. Is it still? Yeah, it's still doing. It's pretty slow if you do it one item at a time. Okay, so let's first disable the channel to explain another thing. Say you have multiple things here. Let's do it like that. So the channel set to round robin, but if I enable the channel again, it will first extract here only and distribute them in a round robin way. Let's get these again. Say I want to extract in round robin from these as well. So then you can do it like this, random or order. Order is actually a way of saying round robin. And then see how it will do it one by one here as well. So now you have round robin on the channel, which means it will get distributed in the output, and also round robin on this single input, individual round robin, so which means it will go over all items in the chest and not just to the first slot only. So that's a few things that you can do here. One thing you can also do, so with advanced connectors you can go a bit faster, and they have other advantages as well. So you can just upgrade a connector with the upgrade kit, sneak right click, and now you see it has changed colors. And now you can set it to, you should be able to set it to 5. Oh. That's not the one I wanted to convert, of course. This one. Yeah. So now it should go. Yeah, see? It's going a little bit faster already. So that's an easy way to convert. Also, what you can do with advanced connectors. Here you can change the size it's up. But with an advanced connector, you can you can exact as if your connector is on another side of the block. For some devices, like for example furnace from vanilla, that can be useful. So you don't need to have connectors on all sides. So that's the basics of XNet there. There are different kind of channels. You have logic, storage, item, fluid and energy. Logic is a bit special. You can set conditions, for example, create a sensor. It's not an advanced, so it doesn't matter. Sensor mode, item. If you have more than one item or more than 10 items, hold on, let's disable this channel and let's get all these back. just want to demonstrate something. And let's put all of this back here. So, if we have in the last output chest, that's that one, more than 10 items, we set the output color to white. So when the condition is true, it will set the global color, which is valid for the entire controller. And based on that color, but let's actually do it like that. We set it to white if it's less than 10. And based on that color, you can do, you doesn't have to be here, but you can say that this insert node is only valid if color is white. So what happens now, if we would insert or enable the channel, or let's also do another sensor here, item less than 10, output color red, input create, item less than 10, color green. Okay, so now we have sensors on all of them. It stopped because the sensors, they all have, yeah, this is one more, because you have to keep in mind the sensor only runs every 10 ticks, while this one runs every 5 ticks, so it was too fast for the sensor, so it missed one step. So that's one disadvantage that you have to keep in mind, that the sensor isn't running all the time. So if you would use advanced connectors, you can also increase the speed of the sensor. So let's upgrade all of them. And then you would be able to say, for example, 5. And that would make it more accurate. Okay. Few other things. You can also set filters. For example, let's say, get these back. Oh yeah, now the channel starts working again. So, let's insert them back here. So say this chest should only accept smooth stuff. Very easy. If we then enable the channel, what did I do? Oh yeah, it's stuck because it is cut by default. These are not enabled, so it will actually these have all these with the same metadata, I think. We'll go in here, but this is just didn't. So say I want to make that filter exact. So metadata matching. Yeah, now it's only accepting stone. Like that. So there's a lot of control that you can do here. Also you can do this with sensors as well. You can count a specific item. So say this chest, that I count that, then yeah, it's getting new items because it's counting until that one goes to 10. Yeah, and now it stops. And yeah, sensors. There's also output, by the way. You can also, based on something, for example, based on a color, you can output redstone from a specific site. There are item fluid, energy, redstone signal, or off. So various things that you can do here. And let's delete that. By the way, you can, that's a new feature, say you have another controller here, and it also has a setup like that. Let's try it out. And let's pick another one. And let's say that this one is input. Okay. If you then take this channel and you do copy this channel, copy channel, and you then you do paste, it will paste. It will also find out, it will try to match as good as it can, and it found out that this connector is called input, so it will put extract here. But because it didn't find something for the, there was one chest too few, it copied this one to the controller. So it will try to copy as good as it can. So if we remove this, yeah, and put another chest there, it should be able to paste better. Yeah, now it has taken the chests. So that's a new feature. You can also do that for items, it copied everything, including the color, but of course the sensors are missing, so you can copy that channel too. You can also copy connectors and paste them here like that. So that's a flexible way to quickly move items, move channels, of course, copy channels from one device to the other. Okay, so another feature is the router. This allows you to connect independent networks because one controller is limited to 8 channels. If you have a more advanced setup, you may want to connect multiple controllers to each other. And that you can do with the router. So in this simple setup, you want to transfer items from here to there. So I already made the channel, I also already set it to extract. But how does it get over there? First, you need to name the channel. So this is input, and we name this channel, which is output. And then you say input, you publish it by giving it a public visible name. Let's call it transfer. And here you do the same. You see this is a remote channel that is now available. You give this channel the same public name, and now they are linked. And already the items are transferred. So this is one way that you can create links between networks. This can be pretty complex and useful if you have a lot of these setups. So for example, this could be an ore processing facility, or this could be an ore processing facility, and here you could have a network managing power for a builder, which is mining everything. And then you can transfer from one router to the other using this. Another feature is wireless. This is relatively new, and people are also reporting it doesn't always work reliably. I'm still investigating that, but let's try it out. Simple setup here. So this needs power. You have to connect it the router, and you have to give it an antenna because we are short range here. A simple antenna should suffice, because there is also the antenna dish for long range and interdimensional transfer. Okay, so now this one is good. Same setup here. So that's the router. Wireless router. Needs power. Needs to be connected. Needs antenna base and antenna. Yeah, and I think if all is well, it's already working. They are already connected now. So the router remains the same, but you can see here, this is a public channel, which is made published here in this router. And you see the symbol to indicate that it's wireless. And this is now transmitting. By default, channels are private, so that means that they are only for me. Because I made both of the table work. But if you want to connect to a channel that is from someone else, in this case, we'll keep on working because I'm the same person, but then you can also transfer to channels belonging to another player. So in this simple setup, it seems to work fine. I believe it's mostly interdimensional that there could be issues with it, but that's something I need to investigate further. It may work for you without problems. So it's nearly time to wrap up this episode. A few other things I want to show. So you have energy, logic, storage. Storage is a bit special. You know the storage scanner here. You can set this up so it's uses XNet instead of area. So by doing that, so you make a storage scan channel on your controller, and then this allows, because this is limited to 20 radius, by doing that you can using the XNet cables, you can make a much larger network with storages that are connected much further away. But it's time to wrap up this episode now. Next episode we will talk about RF2's control and also tie everything together. See a few example setups of what you can do with all of this. But that's for next time. See you next time. Bye bye.